up your sleeves, pour yourself a drink, because this is Off the Cuff. I'm Dan.
And I'm Kyle. Cheers, everyone. That tastes delicious. I have a good taste in my mouth right now, Dan. And I'm going to elaborate on this a little bit, because I'm feeling good right now.
This was a good flick.
I'm feeling really good right now. Like, I gotta say, guys, I feel like we've been watching some shit lately.
We have been watching some shit
lately. Get Out, on the other hand, was pretty good. Get Out was pretty good.
Get Out was pretty good.
I liked a lot of things about it, but it didn't blow me away. Just didn't. You guys can watch that episode if you haven't seen it. Put a fucking thing in the description or something like that. But, God, am I surprised.
Today, guys.
Yeah, roll us in, man. Roll us in.
We went to see the critically acclaimed, and I can say that.
Now. You can? Wow. That's not a joke anymore.
The critically acclaimed Logan.
Fist fight. Oh, sorry. We already saw that.
Shit. Now, Logan. And, yeah, well, we heard it was good. I mean, matter of fact, as we were walking into the theater, you ran into someone you knew, and they said it was super good. And
yeah, shout out to my boy Travis from Blackfish. What's up, man? I know you're not watching this, but that's cool.
Totally is good. Yeah, I kept hearing this and Get Out were great movies.
We also saw our friend Colin when we went to go see Get Out. He had just seen Logan and said it was awesome. Oh, so okay. I guess we've heard good things.
Good things. But browsing the internet, I try to keep myself away from too much information about the movie. So, but I have vaguely come across like some Rotten Tomatoes scores and stuff like that.
Well, it's been in the news, man. Like, it's definitely garnered a lot of attention. Like, it has a 92 in Rotten Tomatoes currently, which is pretty crazy. Like, hear me out. Like, this is just my thing. Like, going into this, I did not expect much. Even though I heard so many good things, and, like, the trailer looked pretty cool. It just looked really gritty. And my whole thing with that is kind of, like, that can go one of two ways. Either can be great, or it's like you're trying really hard,
and
you know?
You're totally right. I was super excited when I saw the trailer for this.
Yeah, you were into
it. 9 months ago now. I was super stoked and thought, like, wow, this is going to be a fucking Wolverine movie that I want to see. And
have you ever said that before? twice before, and you've been burned twice.
Yes, exactly. So, but I love the gritty action. I love Wolverine as a character.
Right.
And I genuinely love Hugh Jackman, so...
Yeah, I mean, like, he is this role. Like, I don't know, like, we might see a new Wolverine in the future. I guess we kind of have. No spoilers. But, like, in a way...
No fucking spoilers.
Yet, well, right? Okay, it's in the fucking trailer. If you're familiar with anything, it's not that bad. Anyways, whatever. I'm not getting into it. There's not actual another Wolverine in this movie. I will clarify that. Yeah. But... You know, he is, like, Hugh Jackman, he has the look, right? Like, the chops, the side chops, the hair, you know, he adapted that look so well in the first X-Men movie, and it just went off running with that.
Yeah, it totally caught on. Now, I kind of want to point out something that Red Letter Media had mentioned, not about this movie specifically. I'm waiting to watch the episode because I hadn't seen the movie until tonight, but they had mentioned... a trend that they're noticing within the box office, that you have the first weekend to decide whether or not a movie's going to flop or not. And generally speaking, across the board, viewings stop or drop by up to 70%, between like 40% and 70%.
The retention value is nothing. I mean, we live in the YouTube age, right, where people have a minute long attention spans. So you know, that's
max.
It makes
sense. And people are spreading the word about what they thought, and they're summarizing the story, and people are catching spoilers.
Yeah.
And so I think word of mouth happens so fucking quick sometimes these days that people just don't even take the time to go see it. You know, opening weekend happens, and they find out everything they want to know. Or were curious about the movie, and then they never end up going to see it.
Like, literally, come the Monday, it might not be worth your time.
Yeah, it's like, imagine the anticipation back when the internet didn't exist of a fucking new TV series, like Wednesday's episode of whatever, Carnation Street. Right. How fucking stoked were you for that?
Not at all, but can you please elaborate on your love for Carnation Street?
No, I actually don't like Carnation Street. It was just the first show that came to your mind, though. It really is.
All right.
Cool. But imagine that was the case, you know what I mean? You have this anticipation, everybody's fucking watching it.
How until I'm 86, so I can look forward to Carnation Street. Every week. No, I see what you're saying, though. That's true, though. Like, there's anticipation. I mean, like, I don't know. I kind of think this might just be nostalgia playing a factor, but I feel like our generation kind of growing up was maybe one of the last to kind of have that.
Yeah, totally.
Like, obviously, we had the internet, and we had, like, you know, movie forums, comic book movie forums, all that shit was accessible, but it wasn't as accessible in a way.
Yeah, it wasn't nearly as present as it is now.
You had to be a fan to find it. It wasn't just, like, you know, it wasn't just, like, on your Facebook feed or something like that, you know?
And back in the day, like, when we were growing up, yeah, MSN and the internet was around and we fucked around on MSN.
I think IGN might have been the only thing that may have been giving us a lot of, like, that kind of content.
But at the same time, it's, like, it was just easier to go and talk to your friends. Like, you didn't spend a lot of time. Like, we spent time playing video games, but we spent most of our time watching movies and then walking down the street to our buddy's place or biking around outside. Like, we had that difference
between... We would play video games at the movies. We'd often bring our DSs and PictoChat in the theater.
Yeah, that was one of our things, which is fucking weird to think about now. But
almost no sense.
But I think that's just the difference between some newer generations and ours. Totally. Was we had like a taste of what our parents had, and we have a taste of what these newer generations had.
But you're bringing up a good thing about anticipation too. Like, there were certain movies, I guess hype's still a thing, right? Mm-hmm. But there were so many movies. Like, I mean, Spider-Man 3, I will always say this, was the one movie growing up that I was so excited for. And I mean, I still like it as a guilty pleasure. The movie is hot garbage, but you know, what can you do? Like, it's just, that's just the way it goes. I think everyone has that movie that, you know, let them down due to hype, or maybe rose their expectations. Anyways, I think that's actually a good segue into the Wolverine series, because this is the third Wolverine movie, technically. I'm a little blurry on if there's any connectivity within this. I'm going to confidently say not really.
Yeah, I'm going to...
There might be a small, like, Easter egg-y things. Again, that's probably a good second viewing kind of potential things to look out for.
Nothing I noticed this time around, like, nothing
like
significant.
Or, like, apparent, like, to the plot, at least. So, in 2009, there was X-Men Origins Wolverine, which is kind of a confusing title, honestly.
Oh, is that the one where he chops the helicopter in half or whatever the fuck?
Yes, that is. It also features Will.i.am and Ryan Reynolds as Deadpool before Ryan Reynolds starred as Deadpool. So.
Oh, right, yeah.
I remember actually this movie leaked on the internet like super far in advance. I think actually I brought you back this movie on DVD China, I'm pretty sure. It might have been Isaac, actually, maybe. Never mind. I think I brought you back to The Office, but it was just like the first scene. Anyways.
and it was the British.
Just the British. Whatever. Anyways, I was just so stoked because DVDs were so cheap.
But yeah, look at the... what was the budget on X-Men Origins Wolverine?
The budget was $150 million. I mean, I don't know what that is adjusted for inflation, because this is already like... This is like almost 10 years ago.
Right. But, you know... Looking at the budget for this, for Logan, is $97 million.
Kind of a, actually, hold on, I need to look at something. So, for a comic movie, that is a fucking, that is totally, that's a budget movie as far as I'm concerned. Considering, like, what fucking Age of Ultron cost and shit like that, like, those movies are huge. Like, they cost, I think, Superman, Batman, shenanigans, shit, that cost almost, like, half a billion dollars, because they knew they were gonna make at least a billion off of it. Like, yes, exactly. That's what I thought. Like, Deadpool only cost $58 million. Yeah. And we won't talk too much about the second Wolverine movie. It was just kind of like meh. But I will say though that I think this movie is a direct result of Deadpool's success. I do finally think that.
Right. And you said that in the theater, and I agree and I don't. I think it's a really great R-rated movie. I guess I could attribute some of its success to, or some of its grittiness or its style coming off of the hype around Deadpool, because it did push a lot of boundaries, which I appreciate about the movie. But at the same time, I think maybe... The credit is not necessarily super due to Deadpool.
Well, it's the same studio. It's the same studio, same producers. They take a gamble on these movies, right?
Right.
And if Deadpool wasn't successful, I think we probably would have got this movie, but I don't think we would have got the movie we got, if that makes any sense.
Right.
I think it would have been Logan. It maybe would have been like 14A or PG-13. We wouldn't have nearly as much gore or swearing. And I'm just happy we got that.
I have to say, if that was the case, if this was a PG-13 movie and it wasn't as gory and it wasn't as gritty, and Logan's performance would have come across a little bit more sweetheart kind of a thing, I don't think I would have really liked the movie that much, to be honest with you. I think that's really what drove it home for me.
At least
the setup.
I agree with you, but not totally. I think overall, if the tone stayed the same, I would still like this movie. now you could attribute like the maturity of the language and, you know, the action part of the tone. And that's what kind of where I agree with you. But overall, this movie has a really nice, like, subtlety to it. And it doesn't go too off the rails, but when it does, it feels warranted. Like, there's some really fucking goofy parts of this movie. And we won't really.
Yeah, there is some goofy,
like,
shit.
Like, really goofy shit, especially near the end. And I think we both agree that we hate the main protagonist, I guess, or the final boss, you could say.
Yeah. The antagonist there. Yeah. And I mean, I think the combination of that and a couple other bleak scenes with some of the kids that show up in this movie is kind of what turned me off. But honestly, most of that took place in the second half. Like, the beginning and the early stuff was really fucking have my attention. Totally. Enough so that when those goofy kind of shitty scenes happened in the second half, it didn't turn me off. Like, I still thought it was a good movie.
And I think a lot of it came down to, like, child actor performance, honestly. Yeah. They really set up the story to include those kids to some extent.
They do.
Sure, maybe they had a little bit too much screen time. That being said, if they gave better performances, that maybe I would have enjoyed it more. Because, right, like, the main girl in this movie, there's a little girl traveling with Logan and Professor Xavier. She's, like, I mean, she's not a fantastic actress, but she's competent. She's fine, you know, she's...
And the idea is to get to Eden, or a safe place, because they're running away from this group who's essentially trying to... The same group that are...
They're like Magneto's ideals. They want to control the mutants.
Right, but previously they had exterminated the mutants. Previous to this, they had exterminated them.
Yeah,
the predecessor version of this company is now trying to control the mutants and essentially sell them as weapons. But so they're trying not to refer to these kids that have been born and grew up in captivity, I guess. Trying not to refer to them as people, trying not to treat them with any form of humanity. They're forcing them to use their powers, but the kids aren't responding. So they're shutting down the program. So that begins the premise of this movie, because the nurses who have helped and doctors who have helped raise these kids set the kids free.
Yeah. They have empathy for them. They want to see them succeed.
Exactly. Yeah. And so now this company is trying to eradicate them because
they're failed experiments in a way.
Exactly. Yeah. To them, they're failed experiments, and they think they found a better solution.
And, you know, we won't discuss the agency behind why Logan is traveling with this girl, this little girl, and why he meets up with these kids, because I think that's kind of integral to the plot.
Yeah, we'll leave that out, it's not super necessary for us to talk about.
I gotta say, this movie, like, it just has so many wacky elements in a way. Like, I still stand by that it's really, like, subtle and calm, but it almost feels like, hear me out, this movie is like a four-piece combination in my mind. It's like 25% The Wolverine, not X-Men Origins, but the second Wolverine movie.
Yeah.
Specifically the first half, because the first half of that movie is actually really fucking good.
Right.
The end is bullshit. It's stupid. Yeah. It's fucking stupid. It's kind of like what I was talking about. It's like you either do super wacky, if you try to do something super serious, you have to keep it serious, or if you don't, then it's just going to be so weird. The first half of that movie is really gritty and really serious, and it works. The second half is too goofy. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Anyways, 25% The Wolverine, 25% like Mad Max.
Right.
25% The Last of Us, and 25% Baby Geniuses. That's what I'm going with.
Fuck, that's an odd mix.
Like, that's a weird mix. But hear me out, guys. It fucking works. Like, it actually works.
Well, it's a really well-told story for the most part.
It's the right elements of those things I mentioned. Maybe not exact. Those are the things that came to mind. Like, The Last of Us totally felt like this. Like, especially near the end. Or maybe, like, the
especially
middle
because
point.
This movie does take place in the future. What did they say? 2027 or something
like
that?
Yeah,
yeah.
Like, at least, like, 20-ish years later.
So, it's pretty far into the future, especially from when the last one took place, which
so
was, what, 2013
or
something?
So glad there wasn't, like, fucking, like, flying spaceships and shit. I'm glad this was like a realistic like 2030 kind of thing.
Yeah, the only way that you would be able to tell that it was the future was maybe based on a couple cars.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
or
some technology, but even then, that's like
some very
comic book technology. So I'm not really like
And I mean,
you know, I'm not
it's
that, my
really
disbelief
not far
is
out
fine on that. No, man, like. I need to reinstate this. So, like, the last two X-Men movies were disappointments. The fact they even the last two Wolverine movies were disappointments. Mm-hmm. The fact they even made a third one is almost shocking to an extent. Like,
right. And I think the argument that the producer of this movie probably had was like, this is summing everything up. This is right. going to be yes. our hard finish, well, and we're going to finish strong kind of a
Hugh
thing.
Hugh Jackman like made an official announcement that this would be his last role as Wolverine, like months before the movie was even, before there was trailers and shit.
Right.
So that was kind of people's only impression of this movie, was that this would be his last time being Wolverine or being on screen as Wolverine. And, you know, like the director of this movie, James Mangold, he also directed The Wolverine, the second one. God, these names are so fucking confusing to talk about. And like, I'm looking at his filmography and like, I like some of his movies too. Like Girl Interrupted, great movie. Walk the Line, great movie. 310 to Yuma, great movie. Night and Day, terrible movie. That's okay though. Yeah, I don't know. Like,
he's got a similar theme, I'd say, through a lot of his movies. Which
like
is...
the tone is similar. Like it's very, it's, I don't know. It's a little, it almost feels like an indie movie to me in a way, a little bit. Like kind of, it has that, like this movie almost reminded me a little bit of Blue Ruin to a degree.
That's a weird comparison.
Like just a little bit.
I think it's like, a little bit more budget.
It has that loneliness. Well, I don't know. Like low budget is kind of, I agree with you. But it's also kind of like, it's hard to describe that. Like, what is low budget?
Well,
you know what
I mean? Feel like where the budget of most of these movies is going these days is A, advertising, and then B, extra special effects that sure can sometimes be cool, but a lot of the times are just fucking waste and you need to spend more time on the story here, dude. But yeah. In this case, I think they spent their money really well and they didn't have a lot to go with. And this, of course, being compared to previous Wolverine movies and other superhero movies. 97 million. So I think that, you know, the majority of the 97 million here went towards paying Hugh Jackman.
Yeah, I gotta imagine that guy got a good cut. Or maybe not. Like, it's weird too, right? Because like X-Men Origins Wolverine is hot fucking garbage. It's a terrible movie. And it had $150 million to spend on it, and this movie spent $50 million less and is a far better looking movie.
Yeah.
Not
and
even
see
just
that-
in terms of it being a better movie, but it looks better. It's a much more, the production quality is immensely.
And
better.
I think that's what they did, is they decided, hey, let's scrap all these useless fucking massive spaceship and neon lights and jumping on buildings scenes and spend it on making this movie's gore really pop and the grittiness make sense and that kind of a thing.
The
right?
best part of X-Men Origins Wolverine, I think, is when Deadpool gets his mouth sewed shut so he can't talk. That actually happened.
I'm so glad fucking Ryan Reynolds could not talk for one time during a
fucking
movie.
Honestly, also,
that dude's so annoying. I can't fucking stand him.
I had like a bad taste in my mouth going into this movie. Like I was like, hey, Logan, whatever, it might be good. We've talked about this a lot of times on the show.
We're
not into it, so when we go see a movie like this, we're apprehensive as can be, basically.
Yeah.
Fucking the first trailer is Fast 8, or F8, or the fuck, Fate of the Furious.
Yeah.
Dude, we watched that trailer before Get Out. I think we just brought it up in the last cast, too.
Fuck me,
I hate that shit. Pisses me off. I, like, was not into it. And then the movie literally opens up with, like, a dead trailer for Deadpool 2. So, like, honestly, my spirits can be lower. Theoretically, like speaking, but man, this movie, it's just a really good time at the movies. This is like, I don't know, I hope this doesn't get glazed over too much, or like people don't like,
yeah, I hope the discussion on it doesn't stop because, here, because like, there's a lot to be said, and I'm definitely gonna watch this movie again. Who like, knows, that we might come to a podcast in the future, we're not sure yet, but
I mean I want to watch it again. Like, this is, hey, I often wonder these kind of things. I always think about movie releases and when things are put out and like the mindset, the behind the scenes mindset and when things are released. And I mean, I have to wonder if this movie came out in like, you know, May or June, what kind of like blockbuster success
like,
would it have?
Would it be that fucking big summer
like,
movie?
Would it be the next Dark Knight? It's not as good as that, but it has a similar, you know.
It does have a similar air about it. Yeah, it's almost too bad that it wasn't categorized. And I think maybe a lot of this has to do with the studio saying, okay, listen, we got other shit going on. Yeah, right. You can make your fucking movie Logan and sum up the series, but we ain't giving you a $150 million budget. We're giving you 97 mil and you're getting a fucking March slot. But kind of a thing.
It's true, you know. That's a good point.
You know what
point.
I mean?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You know, I'm sure that I'm exaggerating for effect here, but
yeah.
Likely, I think you know, time and place could have played a lot in the success of this movie. And I'm not saying that it's dead. I'm just saying that it's good and it could do even better.
Well, you know, you bring up a good point. Like, they probably were very strategic on, you know, saying, like, this is the slot you're going to get. And I think, actually, you know, like, kind of second guessing myself right now, there's fucking a lot of superhero movies coming out this summer. There's, like, the Thor Ragnarok movie and Wonder Woman and Justice League. So, in hindsight, under the sun, put this out in March. You know what I mean? Like, why not? Like,
yeah, break it up.
Well, Deadpool was successful as fucking February, so why can't Logan do well in March? Like, I think this is the mindset they're going with, and it's worked twice in a row for him. I mean, I don't know. I think Logan is a far, far better movie than Deadpool. And I mean, the one thing we said last year, you can go back and watch, said the one thing Deadpool might bring is better R-rated movies. And as far as I'm fucking concerned, it brought
They're following up with that. And so, yeah.
And I'm feeling really good about that. You're right, it might not be a direct correlation, but I do think that there's a bit of that, considering they're the same studio and there was so much buzz about Deadpool being the highest grossing R-rated movie of all time, things like that. So it has to be a thing. Hollywood is all about money.
They're fighting for that. And you know what? I just want to make the comparison before we get off this topic and move on to a little bit more about the movie that, you know, sometimes really great artists don't know what their best-selling pieces are. And I think sometimes studios don't know what their best movies are going to be. And this one was fucking better than Deadpool, guys. So
let's
make more movies like this.
I mean, Robert Rodriguez once said that Sharkboy and Lavagirl was the best movie ever directed.
Yeah. I mean, he maybe said that just to fucking have an interview on file that he could show his kid. Listen, I made this movie for you.
It was on the director's commentary on the DVD. Guys, if you have that, fucking listen to it. It's so funny. It's so funny. I have that copy because, actually, if anyone has a Blu-ray copy of Sharkboy and Lavagirl, hit me up on that. I'm trying to find one and they're hard to come by.
Oh, my God.
Anyways, yeah, moving on to the movie a little bit. I don't know. My main points really are just I love the tone. I think it's serious when it needs to be. It doesn't take itself too serious. And when it is silly, it's comic book. So, like, we have to remember here, guys, that these are comic book movies. Mm. Like, I mean, I love how we've got to a point now where we can take the subject matter and, you know, the story from comic books and adapt them to, you know, adult themes and adapt them to movies for all ages, young and old. But at the end of the day, you know, there are things that are made for, like, slightly lighter media, and they're things that when we enjoy growing up with, you know, these comic books don't take themselves too seriously. They're not all Watchmen, you know what I mean? Like, the X-Men necessarily isn't the most serious comic book series ever. There's definitely serious moments, 100%. Yeah. But that's why it works. It has its serious moments, it has its goofy moments, and I think that's what Logan adapts
well. It has its superhero-y moments, yeah. And I think that's definitely, yeah, you're right. This is something that this movie succeeds at. They even showcase Logan's weakness and the fact that he's getting old and he's, you know, he can't regenerate.
Dude, he has a mad hobble.
Yeah, he's got a hobble in his walk. Maybe too soon on that one there, but
it's been a while.
I mean, he's not where he was in The Wolverine, fucking whatever Wolverine.
Right, no, okay.
You know what I mean? He's not nearly as physically fit. He's got some issues. He's even more dark and dreary. Like, if he was depressing in The Wolverine, fucking dude is hella depressing in this movie.
Well, isn't there the comic, you might know more about this than I do, it's called, like, Old Man Logan or something like that? Like, isn't that what this is based on, I think?
I don't know for sure.
I think that's, like, I could be making this the fuck up, but I think that is true. I think it's based on the Old Man Logan.
I'm pretty sure there's a comic book where he does get age.
Right. I mean, it's kind of like Bruce Wayne. That happens to him, too. Like, he gets much older. He's an older Batman, and there's things like that.
Well, and technically, in one comic book world, and again, I can't speak to this too much. Like, Bruce Wayne is actually dead. I'm sure there's a world where fucking Wolverine is dead too. But
yeah, there's all that shit. I like that though. How, like, this movie is, you know, it's still an X-Men movie. It's still connected to the universe, but it's not a direct sequel. There's not, like, characters that are brought back just for the sake of it. And the one that is Professor X, he's in the trailer. I can say that.
Yeah.
It's there because he's arguably the most important character in the whole series to a degree. Like, he's there for a reason.
And yeah, if there's anyone that has a connection to Logan, if there's anyone that Logan would fucking basically stay alive for, because in this movie, he's fucking basically wishes he wasn't around, because life is fucking pretty hard. Yeah, for him. So, yeah, yeah. I mean, if there's one person he would stay alive for, it's Professor X.
Totally. And that makes sense. And, it works, man. Also, fucking, I love how it's called Logan. Honestly.
Yeah. Way to separate yourself from the other shitty movies.
Fuck. And also, I think it's a good way to maybe, just, like, have everyone be a little bit more interested in it. It's kind of like, oh, what's this Logan movie about? Who is that? Oh, it's Wolverine. What? Like, I don't know. There's more mystique around it. Like, it would suck if it was called The Wolverine Logan. Or, like, yeah. X-Men Logan. I don't know. Some shit like that.
Something I am a little bit confused about. His name is James, a.k.a. Logan.
I was thinking that, too.
So where does Logan come from? Is Logan his middle name, maybe? Is there maybe, like, a part of the plot where he's like, don't call me James, call me Logan or some shit? Like, I don't know. Is that a thing that ever happens? Maybe. Or, I mean, it's hard to say.
We're doing live fact checks.
I'm trying to figure out if you know how Richard, the nickname for Richard is Dick, and it doesn't really make any sense. Was a Richard that was a dick once upon a time.
This is some from the comics. He flees with his childhood companion Rose and grows into manhood on a mining colony in Yukon, adopting the name Logan. So he basically takes upon a fake name.
Oh, he forfeits his name when he becomes a man. Is that kind of what they're getting at? Maybe.
Sure. I don't know. I mean, that would make sense to me. Apparently.
Or like forfeiting his previous life and adopting a new name.
I think this is elaborated on in the Wolverine movie, but I completely forget because that movie's like not bad, but it's mostly forgettable.
Yeah.
Truth be told. I don't know, guys. Like, I'm just really stoked on this. Like, this is probably my favorite movie I've seen this year so far. I'm going to say that.
Really?
I think so. I can't think of a better one, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I'm on the fence between this and Get Out.
It wasn't the genre for me. And this movie, shock is a strong word, but I'm leaning towards saying shocked me with how much I enjoyed it. Because no, it's not a fucking perfect movie. It's not made my favorite movie, but God, like, this gives me hope for superhero movies. I'm happy that like Fox is making these kind of offshoot films. Like, even the X-Men movies are pretty damn good. I love First Class and Days of Future Past. Yeah. I haven't seen Apocalypse. Apparently that one's actually pretty shitty, but you know, I can't speak on that. So fuck it. I'm into it. And I hope Marvel and DC take some pointers from this shit.
Exactly. And let's see what else Fox has to offer. And you know what? I think that's a good place to leave it.
Yeah, you're going to give a recommendation for this?
Yeah, absolutely I would, yeah.
I'm on that too. I think, guys, if you're looking for a film to check out, it's already been out for a few weeks. The numbers are in. You guys have probably already seen this. If you haven't noticed, we've been recording a few things a little bit earlier to put it out and release. So this is why some of these releases are a little bit...
A little bit behind.
A little less relevant than normal. But, you know, we just want to have some shit out for you guys. So, yeah, man. That's it. Cheers to it.
Cheers.
Guys, have a good week.